People don't like that. For one thing, we were challenging the right to lie in defense of the state. For another thing, we were exposing the apologetics and support for actual ongoing atrocities. That doesn't make you popular.
Where did he learn about the atrocities in East Timor or in Central America, if not in the same free press which he so derides?
You can find out where I learned about them by looking at my footnotes. I learned about them from human rights reports, from church reports, from refugee studies, and extensively from the Australian press. There was nothing from the American press because it was silenced.
Chairman, this is an attempt at intellectual intimidation. These are the ways of the bully. Professor Chomsky uses the oldest debating trick on record. He erects a man of straw and proceeds to hack away at him. Professor Chomsky calls this the manufacture of consent. I call it the creation of consensus. In Holland, we call it draagvlak, which means foundation. Professor Chomsky thinks it is deceitful, but it is not. In a representative democracy, it means winning people for one's point of view. But I do not think that Professor Chomsky believes in representative democracy. I think he believes in direct democracy. With Rosa Luxemburg, he longs for the creative, spontaneous, self-correcting force of mass action. That is the vision of the anarchist. It is also a boy's dream.
Those who believe in democracy and freedom have a serious task ahead of them. What they should be doing, in my view, is dedicating their efforts to helping the despised common people to struggle for their rights and to realize the democratic goals that constantly surface throughout history. They should be serving not power and privilege, but rather their victims. Freedom and democracy are by now not merely values to be treasured, they are quite possibly the prerequisite to survival.
It's a conspiracy theory, pure and simple. It is not borne out by the facts. Mr. Chairman, I have to go to Amsterdam. If you'll excuse me, I'm leaving.
One thing is sure. Their consent has not been manufactured tonight.
There is nothing more remote from what I'm discussing or what we have been discussing than a conspiracy theory. If I give an analysis of, say, the economic system, and I point out that General Motors tries to maximize profit and market share, that's not a conspiracy theory. That's an institutional analysis. It has nothing to do with conspiracies. And that's precisely the sense in which we're talking about the media. The phrase conspiracy theory is one of those that's constantly brought up, and I think its effect simply is to discourage institutional analysis.
Do you think there's a connection somehow about what the government wants us to know and what the media tell us?
It's not communism, but I think to a certain point, it is sensitized.
They don't always tell, I guess, John, they don't always tell the truth the way it goes, huh?
Got that right.
You think that the information you're getting from this paper is biased in any way?
Or? Oh, yeah.
I think by and large, it's well done. You get both sides of the stories. You get the liberal and the side and the conservative side, so to speak.
But I don't think you get a very balanced picture because they only have 20 seconds, 30 seconds for a news item or whatever, and they're going to pick out a highlight, and every network is going to cover the same highlight, and that's all you're going to see.
You get what they want you to hear.
Do you think they're biased in some way then?
Yeah.
Is it possible for the lights to get a little brighter so you can see somebody out there?
Yeah, for the last hour and 41 minutes, I've been whining about how the elite and how the government have been using thought control to keep radicals like yourself out of the public limelight. Now, you're here. I don't see any CIA men waiting to drag you off. You were in the paper. That's where everyone here heard you were coming from in the paper, and I'm sure they're going to publish your comments in the paper. Now, a lot of countries, you would have been shot for what you have done today. So what are you whining about? This is, we are allowing you to speak, and I don't see any thought control.
First of all, I hadn't said one word about my being kept out of the limelight. The way it works here is quite different. Now, I don't think you heard what I was saying, but the way it works here is that there is a system of shaping, control, and so on, which gives a certain perception of the world. I gave one example. I'll give you sources where you can find thousands of others. And it has nothing to do with me. It has to do with marginalizing the public and ensuring that they don't get in the way of elites who are supposed to run things without interference.
In a review of the Chomsky Reader, it was written that as he's been forced to the margins, he's become strident and rigid. Do you feel this categorization of your later writings is accurate and that you've been a victim of this sort of process you've been describing?
Well, the business about being forced to the other people will have to judge about the stridency. I don't believe it, but anyway, that's for other people to judge. However, the matter of being forced to the margins is a matter of fact, and the fact is the opposite of what is claimed. The fact is it's much easier to gain access to even the major media now than it was 20 years ago.
You've dealt in such unpopular truths and have been such a lonely figure as a consequence of that. Do you ever regret either that you took the stand you took, have written the things you have written, or that we had listened to you earlier?
I don't. I mean, there are particular things which I would do differently because you think about things, you do them differently. But in general, I would say I do not regret it. I mean,
do you like being controversial?
No, it's a nuisance.
Because this mass medium pays little attention to the views of dissenters, not just Noam Chomsky, but most dissenters do not get much of a hearing in this medium.
No, in fact, that's, again, completely understandable. They wouldn't be performing their societal function if they allowed favored truths to be challenged. Now, notice that that's not true when I cross the border anywhere, so that I have easy access to the media in just about every other country in the world. There's a number of reasons for that. One reason is I'm primarily talking about the United States, and it's much less threatening.
Your view there is that the militarization of the American economy essentially has come about because there are not other means of controlling the American population.
In a democratic society. I mean, it may be paradoxical, but the freer the society is, the more it's necessary to resort to devices like induced fear.
Okay, I'll go along with that. Arguably, he is the most important intellectual alive today. And if my program can give him 500,000 people listening or 750,000 people listening, I'll be delighted.
Okay, Professor, and you're on time.
Wartime planners understood that actual war aims should not be revealed.
Part of the reason why the media in Canada and Belgium and so on are more open is that it just doesn't matter that much what people think. It matters very much what the politically articulate sectors of the population, those narrow minorities, think and do in the United States because of its overwhelming dominance on the world scene. But, of course, that's also a reason for wanting to work here.
What we might call the fifth freedom, the freedom to rob, exploit, and dominate, and to curb mischief by any feasible means. Let's conclude, not include.
The United States is ideologically narrower in general than other countries. Furthermore, the structure of the American media is such as to pretty much eliminate critical discussion.
Our guests are as far apart on the contra question as American intellectuals can be.
Now, if we had the slightest concern with democracy, which we do not in our foreign affairs and never have, we would turn to countries where we have influence, like El Salvador. Now, in El Salvador, they don't call the archbishop bad names. What they do is murder him. They do not censor the press. They wipe the press out. They sent the army in to blow up the church radio station. The editor of the independent newspaper was found in a ditch, mutilated, and cut to pieces with machete. May I continue? I did not interrupt
don't
you.
Don't you ever want to put a time value on anything you say?
Excuse me. That was 1980.
You are a systematic liar.
Did these things happen or didn't they?
These things did not happen in the context in which you suggest at all. You are a phony, mister, and it's time that the people read you correctly.
It's clear why you want to divert me from the discussion that
I'm... No, it's not. Let me just get tired of rubbish.
But let's continue with...
Except we can't. I'm afraid we're out of time. We thank you.